Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz. Judy Woodruff is away. On the NewsHour tonight, a widespread surge. Coronavirus cases spike nationwide as new infection records are set, and some officials call for a return to more restrictions. Then, abuse in the ranks. Survivors of sexual assault in the military speak out following the harassment and murder of soldier Vanessa Guillen. Plus, friends in high places. The president commutes Roger Stone's prison sentence despite his conviction in connection with the Russia investigation. And it's Monday, so Tamara Keith and Amy Walter break down the latest politics news from the ongoing pandemic response to the campaign for the White House. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
When the world gets complicated, a lot goes through your mind. With Fidelity Wealth Management, a dedicated advisor can tailor advice and recommendations to your life. That's Fidelity Wealth Management.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. Financial services firm Raymond James. The Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone at CZI.org. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The rollback of reopenings is growing tonight as the coronavirus explosion gains new energy. But the man leading the public health fight is increasingly a target himself. White House correspondent Yamiche Alcindor begins our coverage.
At hospitals nationwide, the focus is on the wave of new COVID-19 infections. At the White House, the focus has shifted to attacking Dr. Anthony Fauci, the government's top infectious disease expert. Today, President Trump retweeted critical posts about Fauci. That came after the doctor publicly and repeatedly corrected the president's misstatements. Deputy Chief of Staff Dan Scavino even posted a cartoon of Fauci as a water faucet that needed to be turned off, and branding the scientist as, quote, cowardly. But this afternoon, the president took a milder tack.
I have a very good relationship with Dr. Fauci. I've had for a long time, right from the beginning. I find him to be a very nice person. I don't always agree with him.
The president himself has often made misleading statements about the virus. He has wrongly said that 99% of the cases are harmless and repeatedly claimed the virus will simply disappear. But White House aides insist that it is Fauci who has often been wrong about the pandemic. Fauci did initially discourage the broader public from wearing masks. He has since said officials took that stance in the beginning because they knew shortages were so bad that medical professionals couldn't get enough. Early on, Fauci said historically, respiratory-borne viruses are rarely transmitted through asymptomatic people. Since then, as he and others have learned more about COVID-19, he has said asymptomatic transmission is more prevalent than with other viruses. For his part, Dr. Fauci has said the science around the virus is constantly evolving. Today, he spoke out again about the increase in nationwide cases.
We did not shut down entirely, and that's the reason why when we went up, we started to come down, and then we plateaued at a level that was really quite high, about 20,000 infections a day.
All of this comes as Florida has set a national single-day record for new cases, and intensive care units across the state filled to the brim. Republican Governor Ron DeSantis.
We can't get swept away in fear. We have to understand what's going on, understand that we do need, that we have a long road ahead.
Still, Disney World in Orlando began its phased reopening this weekend as mask-clad visitors flocked the park. But today, California ordered all restaurants, movie theaters, and bars in the state to close down again. It also called for shopping malls, barbershops, and places of worship to close in half of the state. Texas has also been hard hit, and officials in Houston are now calling for the state to halt its reopening efforts and reimpose lockdowns. Houston's Democratic Mayor Sylvester Turner.
Step back a couple of weeks. Let's look at the numbers, look at the data, see where things are, and then gradually move forward again.
Today, the Texas State Supreme Court upheld Houston's refusal to host the state Republican convention in that city as an in-person event. Mayor Turner said it simply could not do so safely. Republican leaders say they will consider their next steps.
Meanwhile, hospitals are buckling under surging admissions. And on Sunday, White House coronavirus testing czar Admiral Brett Giroir pushed the use of masks.
We have to have like 90% of people wearing a mask in public in the hotspot areas. If we don't have that, we will not get control of the virus.
That came just a day after President Trump visited a military hospital in Maryland. There he wore a mask in public for the very first time. At the same time, Education Secretary Betsy DeVos on Sunday continued the president's push to reopen schools in the fall.
There's nothing in the data that suggests that kids being in school is in any way dangerous.
Other nations are also wrestling with the same questions and the same surge in infections. In Mexico, officials there say more than 35,000 people have died from the virus, now the fourth highest tally in the world. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Yamiche Alcindor.
Even as Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, some political leaders and many parents are pushing for a wider reopening of schools, some officials are worried about the risks. Today, California's two largest school districts, the Los Angeles and San Diego Unified Systems, said they will only do instruction remotely this fall. Between the two districts, that affects roughly 825,000 students. In Florida, where infections remain very high, the state's education commissioner wants schools physically open 5 days a week. Some districts are now looking at hybrid models instead. We get reaction to all of this from the president of the teachers union there. Frederick Ingram is with the Florida Education Association, and he joins me now. Mr. Ingram, welcome to the NewsHour. So your union represents thousands of teachers. You yourself are a teacher. What's your assessment? Will the schools be ready for students next month?
Well, thank you for having me, and I appreciate being here. We represent 150,000 educators and school employees across this state. And frankly, I believe our governor and our commissioner of education have been irresponsible. They put out a plan last week to say that we must have a brick and mortar option for 5 days a week. And I think being in the epicenter of this virus, with cases steadily rising every day. In fact, in the next couple of days, our state will eclipse over 300,000 positive cases. I think it's irresponsible to think that our schools, our teachers, or our educational support professionals, or first and most importantly, our students are ready to go back to school in the brick and mortar option.
In the meantime, though, we should mention you have dozens of school districts in the state of Florida. Each one of those districts is coming up with their own plan. They all seem to be in different stages, right? Some have been released, some school boards are voting on them, some are still very much in the works. When you think about how students could physically return to school, do any of those plans catch your attention? Do any of them look like a good plan to you right now?
Listen, kudos to our superintendents, our school boards, our local leaders, our local teachers unions. They're all trying to put their heads together to create plans that will be as advantageous as we possibly can with our students. But they can't do this without some guidance and some regulations and funding. It's going to cost us more money to educate our students than less. We have to deal with ventilations and cleanings of our school buildings. We have to deal with social distancing. That means that we'll have smaller classes. And we have to deal with masks or congregations in terms of our lunchrooms, our buses, our assemblies, or cosmetology class, or chorus, or band. We've gotten no guidelines as to how to do that. Our districts are frantically trying to create these plans, and they've been working really hard this summer. But under the guise of our governor and our commissioner of education, they have given us a slogan: we must open with brick and mortar. They have not given us a comprehensive plan.
Tell me what you're hearing from teachers. What are they worried about right now? And do they see specific steps that they want to see put in place as mitigation efforts before they walk back into schools?
Teachers are scared. Teachers are frankly, they have angst that I've never seen before. Some teachers are making the decisions to retire early simply because they cannot go back into a school because they are either over the age of 60 or they may have an underlying issue. Or a teacher may be healthy and they may be taking care of an elderly parent. Or they may be taking care of their own sick child who has a bronchial issue, who has juvenile diabetes, but they don't want to be the cause of bringing that home from an asymptomatic child. And so we're putting these things in place. Our state has said nothing about reasonable accommodations for our teachers, and that's what they're looking for. If they get sick, what happens? If there's a breakout, if there's a pandemic, a virus episode at a school or a particular feeder pattern, what's going to happen? Do we invite a substitute teacher to come in and teach a class, given the circumstances of a teacher or a child being in that class that's sick? There is no guidance here in the state of Florida, and we have to do better because our kids are depending on us.
Well, let me ask you about those kids then, because there's a lot of concern about the effects that the lockdown has already had. That concern being based on the fact that the gaps that were there before will be widened after kids go back to school. If they didn't have internet access in the spring, they won't have it this fall either. How concerned are you that the longer schools stay closed, some of those kids are just going to fall further and further behind in a way they can't make up?
Sure. Well, let me tell you this. I'm a parent first. I have a 15-year-old who is going to high school this year, and I want her high school to be as safe as it can possibly be, knowing that there will be some academic regression, knowing that she's been out of school for 5.5 months. Listen, from March to May, our lawmakers have put in a testing vacuum that has very little to do with teaching. So I feel like our teachers still will do the magic that they always do. Whenever we get these kids back, be it online or hybrid or brick and mortar, our teachers will do what they need to do. Right now, our parents need to concentrate on exactly the same thing our teachers and our cafeteria workers and our bus drivers and secretaries are saying. This is life or death. Kids will die. People will die because of this virus, and in Florida, we do not have this under control. And we need to concentrate on that so that we can protect our communities and our families. Our teachers will still be there, and our schools will be there as strong as they've ever been, because I have every confidence in our public schools.
So let me just ask you, based on what you've seen so far in the way of the steps the state has been taking, do you see any way that schools could be back open next month safely?
Yes, I do see a way. If our state shows a trend, like the CDC regulations first told us, of 14 days of a decline in getting the virus under control. We have to do that because our schools will become a microcosm of what's going on out in the community. We know that these kids will either be asymptomatic or they will get sick or they will be hospitalized and or they will affect other people. And so we have to see a 14-day decline, which we have not seen over the last 6 weeks here in Florida. So until we get to that point, I don't think that we should even be in the discussions of opening schools one way or another. We should be talking about delaying over maybe a 2-week period of time so that we can see if we're going to get control of this. If not, then we need to talk about the fall itself and moving and shifting to distance learning and doing the very best that we can given the circumstances.
A lot of uncertainty ahead for sure. That is Frederick Ingram of the Florida Education Association joining us tonight. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
In the day's other news, the United Nations warned the coronavirus pandemic could push 130 million more people worldwide into chronic hunger this year. Last year, before the outbreak, the annual UN report estimated 690 million people went hungry. That's nearly 9% of the overall global population and an increase of 10 million from the year before. More than 200 universities have come out in support of a lawsuit against pandemic curbs on international students. The Trump administration is denying visas to those not taking at least one in-person class this fall. The schools filed briefs today backing the suit by Harvard and MIT. In addition, 17 states and the District of Columbia filed a separate suit against the policy. The White House is defending President Trump's grant of clemency to Roger Stone. On Friday, the president commuted his longtime ally's 40-month prison sentence for witness tampering and lying to Congress. Today, the White House press secretary dismissed criticism of that decision.
It's absolutely not the case that only those who are politically connected get a pardon. This president is the president of criminal justice reform. This president did the First Step Act. This president has fought for those who are given unduly harsh sentences more than any Democrat who liked to talk about it but never actually did it.
The presiding federal judge in the case demanded to know today if Stone will still have 2 years of supervised release. The Justice Department said the clemency order wipes out that requirement as well. We'll have more on this later in the program. Tensions between the United States and China are escalating again in the South China Sea. The Trump administration today rejected nearly all of Beijing's territorial claims in the region. In recent years, China has built military bases to back up those claims, and U.S. warships have sailed through the region to contest them. Separately, China announced sanctions today against two U.S. senators, Ted Cruz of Texas and Marco Rubio of Florida. Both have criticized human rights abuses against Muslims in western China. The U.S. Ambassador for Religious Freedom, Sam Brownback, was also included. The sanctions could ban all three from entering China. In Poland, conservative President Andrzej Duda has narrowly won a second term after he defeated Warsaw's liberal mayor in Sunday's vote. Duda apologized today for a campaign that stoked anti-Semitism and homophobia, but gay activists warned of what may lie ahead.
It looks like we live in a country where hatred wins over love. It looks like we live in a country where fear wins over the openness towards others. In a country where lies win over honesty. And I am saying all of this as an ordinary person who is disappointed with people around, disappointed with my neighbors, disappointed with my fellow countrymen.
Duda has reduced poverty in Poland, but has also raised fears that he's curtailing freedom of the press and independence of the courts. Back in this country, more than 1,000 employees of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention are demanding that the agency address internal racism. NPR obtained a letter from the group addressed to Director Robert Redfield. It speaks of, quote, a toxic culture of racial aggressions against black employees. The CDC confirms that Redfield received the letter but says nothing of his response. Washington, D.C.'s NFL franchise announced today it will change its name, long criticized as a racial slur against Native Americans. The team also retired its Indian head logo. The move comes after years of protests and just days after the franchise launched a formal name review under pressure from corporate sponsors. There's no word yet on what the new team name will be. The U.S. budget deficit hit an all-time high of $864 billion in June. That came amid increased spending to counter the pandemic's economic toll and a massive decline in tax revenue. Meanwhile, trading was rocky on Wall Street today. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 10 points to close at 26,086. The Nasdaq plunged 226 points, and the S&P 500 shed 30. And two passings of note. Actor Kelly Preston has died of breast cancer, according to her husband, John Travolta. Her movie highlights included Jerry Maguire in 1996. She was 57 years old. And Naya Rivera's body was found today in a Southern California lake. Officials say she drowned. Rivera starred in the former TV series Glee, and she was just 33 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, the mayor of Alexandria, Virginia, discusses the balance between reopening and public safety amid the pandemic. Survivors of sexual assault in the military speak out following the harassment and murder of soldier Vanessa Guillen. The president commutes Roger Stone's prison sentence despite his conviction in connection with the Russia investigation, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
We often talk about the implications of COVID-19 on a national level, but a lot of the decisions that directly impact our lives are made by local governments. We want to take a moment now and focus on how those decisions are made. So a few days ago, I spent time with the mayor of my own hometown, Alexandria, Virginia, for a closer look.
Our vehicle traffic obviously is a lot less now.
Friday afternoon in Old Town, Alexandria. And Mayor Justin Wilson is walking the city's main drag.
This allowed more space for distancing.
This is what phase three of Virginia's reopening looks like.
What's it like for you to come out now and see businesses open and people outside dining?
It is definitely good to see. Everyone's tables are separate. Folks are mostly doing the right thing. But it comes with, of course, some trepidation, right? You know, because you don't want to see a situation where we're back where we were.
Alexandria's a small city, about 160,000 residents, many whom cross the river into Washington, D.C. every day as federal workers. The economy here depends on small businesses like these. Restaurants, independent retailers, mom-and-pop stores, all of them hit hard in the pandemic.
This is going to be definitely a three-year recovery program at a minimum.
Mayor is a part-time gig here. Wilson also works for Amtrak. But trying to stabilize his city's economy has now become an enormous job.
You know, we have what was an $800 million budget that we lost $92 million out of, which is an enormous hit for us. And so we want to get our economy back going.
The financial impact for Alexandria is immense. In April of last year, dining out yielded $2.2 million in tax revenue. This year, just $570,000. From hotel stays, April 2019 brought in $1.3 million. This year, that was down to just $96,000. Already, pay freezes are in place for City Hall staff. Layoffs are a possibility.
If this is a prolonged multi-year thing, this is going to be dramatic for us. It's going to be very, very significant.
And the blow to the city budget means badly needed infrastructure work won't get done.
You mentioned a $90 million hit.
Yeah,
90,
92, yeah.
What does that mean for a city like Alexandria?
The biggest question is, how sustainable is it going to be? Is that a $92 million one-time hit? We deferred a whole bunch of capital projects. We drew down on some of our reserves. So a planned rebuild of a high school is going to be delayed for a couple years. Waterfront flood mitigation work is going to be delayed for several years.
There is pushback against Wilson's push to reopen. Northern Virginia had previously coordinated plans with neighboring D.C. and Maryland, which have been more restrictive in their openings. This month, that changed, and Mayor Wilson pressed ahead with the rest of Virginia to relax restrictions. Alexandria's had nearly 2,500 COVID cases and almost 60 fatalities. Critics worry the reopening has fueled further spread of the virus.
We understand that the prerequisite of any economic activity is public health. Even in some of the states that rushed reopening learned that you can open everything. People aren't going to show up unless they feel safe. A lot of businesses are making plans around reopening.
Some kind of schedule.
Yeah, and trying to at least adopt to some new normal. And so the last thing we wanted to see is have to go backwards.
Like much of the country, black and brown residents here have been hardest hit. Wilson says resistance from the federal government to help undocumented workers and others who need it most remains a problem.
What specific steps would you want to see from the federal government that would help your community right now?
What I have said every single time I have talked to our both of our senators and our congressmen is just send money. I mean, I hate to say it so simply, but send money. Send money to our residents, send money to our businesses.
Hey, how you doing, man?
For his part, the mayor is trying to lead by example, masking up in public, safely interacting with neighbors, and running a one-man social media PR machine for local restaurants, featuring new outdoor dining or curbside pickup options. But like local leaders across the country, his optimism is tempered by the uncertainty ahead.
Are you worried that there could be another spike in cases?
If you find me someone who is confident about anything in this environment, they're lying to you because this is unprecedented, right? You know, we are all making decisions that have no rule book. There's no other jurisdiction you can consult. There's no scholarly journals you can look at. But yeah, I'm absolutely concerned.
The disappearance and murder of Army Specialist Vanessa Guillen has sparked an outpouring of stories from mainly female service members with one common thread. Like Guillen, they experienced sexual harassment and abuse in the ranks, but felt that the military's reporting system wasn't built to help them. In a moment, Nick Schifrin speaks with two experts about what needs to change. But first, he has some background on Guillen and the stories of women in their own words who are part of the hashtag #IAmVanessaGuillen movement.
Vanessa Guillen was 20 years old when she died. Her family says she's always wanted to be in the military to protect the country, but they say the military failed to protect her. Guillen told them that she'd been harassed by a higher-ranking soldier, but because of a culture of fear at the base and in the Army, she felt too afraid to report it. She went missing on April 22nd. Her body was found more than 2 months later. She'd been struck by a hammer, burned, and partially dismembered. The police zeroed in on the man the family says was her harasser, Aaron Robinson. When they approached him, he died by suicide. Outside Fort Hood, there's a memorial for Guillen. And in Houston, a march calling for justice and accusing the military of failing to defend its female service members. On Thursday, Secretary of Defense Mark Esper admitted the military could do better.
We've made a lot of progress over 10 years, but nowhere near we need to be. We need to get to zero tolerance of sexual harassment and sexual assault, and we need to make sure that everybody in our ranks knows where they can go to for help, where they can find help.
Congress has a major piece of legislation called the Military Justice Improvement Act that would remove the chain of command from the decision to prosecute sexual harassment and abuse claims. But this moment is different. The viciousness of the crime and a social media campaign with the hashtag #IAmVanessaGuillen has highlighted what countless female veterans say, that Guillen's story, sadly, is not unique. We spoke to a half dozen veterans, women victims of sexual harassment or assault, who say they were initially silenced, but thanks to Guillen, they are silenced no more.
My name is Joanna Sweat, and I'm a United States Marine Corps veteran.
My name is Tiffany Suma. I am an Army veteran.
My name is Renee Yesman.
My name is Stephanie Flores.
My name is Ashley Martinez.
My name is Georgina Butler.
2 months into my duty assignment, I was raped by another soldier.
I was sexually assaulted by someone I knew.
In October of 2016, I was at a party off base with some of my friends, and then I just remember waking up on my front yard.
I was wearing brown sweatpants and a tan army t-shirt. And the next evening I woke up and I was not wearing that. And I had blood on me and I was covered in vomit.
And my first ship, I personally experienced sexual harassment from my direct supervisor, right? And it was a lot of sexist comments, a lot of sexual language and comments towards me. I didn't even know about the assault, the act, or anything. That's how blacked out I was.
They made me actually call the male that they found his DNA. It took me an hour to build up the courage to even pick up the phone. I was scared. I was crying.
They had all the evidence of him saying, yes, I do remember the night. Yes, I did do that. And they still, for some reason, said there was not enough evidence. I chose, like Vanessa, not to report it. Like a lot of people say, the only difference between me and her story is that I walked away alive.
With Vanessa Guillen's story, I think I saw myself in her. I was a young Hispanic enlisted soldier. I was also too scared to tell my mother my attacker's name.
I went to my chain of command and I told them what happened, and I was immediately told to bury this.
They made me feel like I wasn't a victim, that it was me that initiated it by going to a party. And they kicked me out for having PTSD, and he stayed in.
The first thing that they told me was like, well, you are new to the military. No one is going to believe you, or nothing is going to get done.
The first questions that I were asked were you drinking? How much were you drinking? And what were you wearing? I ended up dropping the case because I didn't feel comfortable prosecuting my attacker because I didn't have faith in the system.
My two friends thought that it was appropriate to go speak to one of our school instructors who happened to be on duty that day. He had a very candid conversation with me about how that would negatively affect my life if I were to report such a crime.
I would like the what were you wearing to stop? What did you do? Because in reality, there's no way to protect yourself against somebody who has this in their mind to do it.
I really started to experience debilitating migraines. Eventually, I was medically discharged because I was unable to perform my daily duties. I still live with the trauma every day.
I still go to therapy every week. I'm on a lot of medications to sleep, to have no nightmares, to function normally. I have a service animal.
I went to the ER, and that's when I started to just like reveal a lot of the things that was happening to me, like a suicide attempt with alcohol and pills.
I know that we all signed up for, and we have to really accept the reality that we may die fighting for this country overseas, but we did not sign up for to be sexually harassed and sexually abused by our own fellow soldiers who we are supposed to fight alongside. I would really like to see some more accountability. I don't know how it's possible that Vanessa was missing for over a month in an institution where supervisors are supposed to have accountability of their soldiers at all times of day.
You can't investigate yourself, and that's what Fourthood does. They send the cases back down to the unit to investigate themselves.
What a lot of the survivors and I have discussed is wanting a separate civilian entity that only deals with military sexual trauma. I shared under the hashtag, and hundreds of people have been in my inbox through Facebook and Twitter wanting to share their stories with me. And for a lot of them, it's the first time they've ever shared their story.
You can't demote me. You can't kick me out of anything anymore. So me using my voice might protect somebody else.
So why is sexual harassment and assault so prevalent in the military, and what can be done about it? For that, we get two views. First, retired Lieutenant Colonel Jeffrey Korn was a former Army lawyer who now teaches criminal law and national security at South Texas College of Law. And former Captain Melissa Bryant served 9 years in the Army as an intelligence officer, including in Iraq. She's now a veterans advocate and a legislative and policy consultant. Welcome to you both to the NewsHour. Secretary Esper was quoted earlier saying that they had made some progress, and I want to list some of the things the military has done over the last few years. DOD is now required to release sexual assault data every year. There's now mandatory training for all service members on what is sexual assault, how to prevent it. Legal officers, known as special victims advocates, are assigned to people to report who report sexual assault. And the chain of command at the colonel or Navy captain level have to be notified of sexual assault cases. Melissa Bryant, have those changes made a difference?
Those gradual changes were absolutely necessary for improved justice. It's been gradually implemented by DOD, but it still doesn't take away influence out of the hands of commanders and put it into those special prosecutors that you just mentioned. The fact that Vanessa Guillen stated to her family that she feared retaliation means that it has not been enough. And we need to take that unlawful command influence out of the military justice system when we're talking about sex crimes like this.
Jeffrey Korn, do you think those changes have made a difference?
I mean, they absolutely have made a difference. And one of the differences has been the increased number of reports of sexual misconduct in the military, which is a double-edged sword because the military is criticized because of increased sexual assault numbers. But those numbers reflect an increase in reporting. I don't think they reflect an increase in the propensity of these offenses to occur. Look, nobody in uniform deserves to suffer the way these women suffered. And there are male victims as well. But there is no evidence that there is a substantial amount of command influence that's implicating the willingness of these convening authorities to send cases to trial when they're presented to them. The challenge has been getting them notified of these incidents, which is why, as you noted, DOD imposed a requirement that all incidents of sexual misconduct be reported up to the colonel or captain level. That's to ensure that junior level commanders don't sweep them under the rug.
But when you're looking at the fact and you're looking at the overwhelming anecdotal evidence that unfortunately does not get captured by the reporting, then that's when we recognize that there is a very real fear of retaliation that still exists. There is a very real command influence that exists over said commanders. And so, yes, while that may be elevated, that convening authority decision to 2- and 3-star general officer, flag officer rank, it still does not improve the issue of bias. That bias is still there. We need to be able to ensure that any form of bias whatsoever, implicit bias, has been removed from the chain of command and removed from from anywhere within the procedures for any pending trial.
Jeffrey Korn, you mentioned increased numbers. Just to put a number on that, Protect Our Defenders say sexual assaults jumped 38% from 2016 to 2018. And also there are surveys that show underreported assaults have also grown. So is that not an indication that the problem is in fact getting worse?
It is actually a manifestation that the efforts to enhance the probability of reporting have been improved. And I think there's a point of consensus between me and Melissa. And I can tell you as a private, the idea that I would go make a report against my sergeant or my captain or my lieutenant was inconceivable. The institution, by its very nature, makes reports by subordinates to superiors extremely difficult, particularly when they perceive there's misconduct. So there is a lot of work that continues and needs to continue to give soldiers, airmen, Marines, and sailors at every level the absolute confidence that they're, if they're candid and honest about an accusation of misconduct. They will not be subject to retribution.
Listen, I was a 20-year-old cadet who is at Fort Hood with an MP unit. I can understand what the pressure that a specialist like Vanessa Guillen could feel. The reason why you need this is because we live and work amongst one another. And that's why you need to remove that bias. We need to be able to ensure that that survivor is able to come forward and not face anyone necessarily from their unit who may have undue influence over the outcomes of justice.
Melissa Bryant, Jeffrey Korn, we'll have to leave it there. Thanks very much to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As we reported earlier, President Trump's decision to commute the prison sentence of his longtime ally Roger Stone is raising questions. Our Lisa Desjardins has this report.
Friday night, Roger Stone, political strategist, lobbyist, and friend and advisor to President Trump, celebrated becoming a free man after Mr. Trump commuted his upcoming three-year prison sentence.
I had a very gracious call from the President of the United States, who told me that he had decided to use his extraordinary powers of clemency to commute my sentence, what he called a full commutation of my sentence.
Stone was convicted by a federal jury of 7 felonies, 5 counts of lying to Congress, and 1 each of witness tampering and obstructing a congressional investigation, all part of the investigation into how he and the Trump campaign got a hold of damaging emails about Hillary Clinton that investigators found were part of a Russian attempt to sway the election.
Roger Stone was brought into this witch hunt, this whole political witch hunt and the Mueller scam.
President Trump maintains the probe by special counsel Robert Mueller was a politically motivated hoax and defended his commutation of Stone's sentence.
I'm getting rave reviews for what I did for Roger Stone.
Stone said he felt confident his conviction would be overturned on appeal anyway.
The president has said on a number of other occasions that he thinks I have a good chance of exoneration.
The president's extraordinary action motivated Robert Mueller to break his year-long public silence, writing in the Washington Post, quote, Stone was prosecuted and convicted because he committed federal crimes. He remains a convicted felon, and rightly so. Mueller wrote his team, quote, identified numerous links between the Russian government and Trump campaign personnel, Stone among them. While the president charges that he and Stone are victims of political bias, his attorney general, Bill Barr, last week defended the Justice Department's case against Stone.
I think the prosecution was righteous.
ABC's Pierre Thomas asked at the time if Barr would recommend President Trump pardon or commute Stone's sentence.
It's the president's prerogative. It's a unique power that the president has, and it's certainly something that is committed to his judgment. But as I say, I felt it was an appropriate prosecution, and I thought the sentence was fair.
Senator Lindsey Graham, a staunch ally of the president's, supported the commutation, noting Stone's offenses were nonviolent. But some other Republicans warned of political fallout, including Maryland Governor Larry Hogan.
It's certainly going to hurt politically.
Meanwhile, Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi called the president's decision, quote, appalling.
And Roger Stone is just the latest high-profile recipient of a pardon or commutation during the Trump presidency. Lisa's here to help put this all into context. Lisa, it's good to see you. Let's start with the context just of this president. When you look at this decision to commute Roger Stone's sentence, how unusual is it?
Well, I spent the day talking to experts, some of whom worked in this office previously, and this is a highly unusual number for 2 reasons. There are 2 things unusual about what the president has done here. First, while the number of commutations is relatively low, it's a small number, it's actually high for this point in any modern presidency. This is the highest number of commutations any president has had at this point in 30 years. The other thing that's unusual, Amna, of course, is who is getting them. Let's look at this graphic to explain. So far, the president has commuted 10 sentences. Of those, at least 3 are people who are personally or politically connected to the president. It does depend on you on how you count it. That number could be higher depending on your definition. Of those, we're seeing Roger Stone, Rod Blagojevich, Voyevich, the former governor of Illinois, and the Hammond brothers, who set fire to some public lands in Oregon, and that became sort of a cause for conservatives. It's important to understand that commutations here are actually somewhat of a higher order than pardons. Commutations, that ends or shortens a prison sentence currently underway or about to start. A pardon, the technical definition of that, is a forgiveness for a felon who's already finished their sentence. So for those of the Justice Department, commutations to some degree are more serious. Now, I will say the president has also issued a large number of pardons. And when you look at where those have gone, roughly about a third, just like the commutations, have gone to people who are personally or politically connected to this president.
So let's look now at the broader American context, right? If you go back into history, have other presidents granted this kind of clemency to political allies? And has there been the kind of political fallout that we just heard in your report, Maryland Governor Hogan, say there could be?
It is so hard to compare almost anything these days to past history. We're in very, very unprecedented days. But President Trump is not the first president to commute or pardon the sentence or the felon record of a political ally or personal friend. Gerald Ford, many of our viewers will recognize, pardoned Richard Nixon. He was not convicted of anything, but ahead of any possible conviction. That was very controversial. Then also after that, George H.W. Bush pardoned six of the co-conspirators in Iran-Contra. Now, Bill Clinton, some of the folks I talked to today say maybe the closest example, though not a perfect analogy to President Trump, he pardoned 140 people on the day he left office. What is the political consequences of that? Well, for Clinton and for George H.W. Bush, they did it on the way out the door. But Gerald Ford did it while he was still hoping to have a future career. Some people arguably say that that was what helped end his career.
So, Lisa, we heard Attorney General Barr also mention there this is, all, of course, perfectly legal. It's within the president's powers. There's been, as we also know, a lot of debate around presidential powers recently. So of all the experts you talked to, where does this fit in to those theories of presidential power?
Well, the founding fathers put this power in the Constitution, Alexander Hamilton particularly, because they wanted to make sure the justice system did not overreach, wasn't overly harsh. They were also wanted to have a place for potential political forgiveness. So Trump is not really in either of those contexts. It's hard to say. One other note, I want to look at how hard it is to get one of these commutations or pardons. Let's look at a graphic quickly. Right now, look at how many of these requests are pending. Over 13,000. Those are processed by a small office of the pardon attorney. Just under two dozen people work there processing those claims. But the White House can intercede. And as we've seen in most of the pardons under this president, the White House has interceded rather than going through the traditional process.
That is Lisa Desjardins with some important context for us tonight. Thanks so much, Lisa. Good to see you.
You're welcome.
Over the weekend, President Trump's critics seized on that stone commutation. The Lincoln Project, a group working to elect Joe Biden in November, released an ad calling the Trump administration a criminal enterprise and listing the members of the Trump team who've been convicted of felonies. Here to break down the political implications of this and more, our Politics Monday team. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and host of Public Radio's Politics with Amy Walter, and Tamara Keith of NPR. She also co-hosts the NPR Politics Monday podcast. Welcome to you both. And let's just start off with that ad. It's worth mentioning, Tam, it was on Friday that President Trump commuted the sentence of Roger Stone. On Saturday, the Lincoln Project had that ad ready to go. An ad like that, leveraging Stone's commutation, what is the messaging there, and who is that messaging going towards?
Well, the Lincoln Project has been sort of a rapid response unit, coming out with ads very quickly whenever President Trump does anything that they think deserves an ad. And some of their ads have been very trolly, like seem to be aimed at an audience of one who might be watching Fox and Friends that morning, the president of the United States. In terms of who they're trying to reach, arguably they're trying to reach Republicans who the last time around in 2016 may have had some discomfort with President Trump, but couldn't bring themselves to vote for Hillary Clinton. And now there is a push, and it's broader than the Lincoln Project, certainly that's just one example. Now there is a push to try to win over people who do feel uncomfortable with President Trump and his norms busting or his handling of the coronavirus. It's not clear to me, though, that the Stone commutation is going to be the thing that puts people over the edge. I mean, President Trump has, as Lisa reported, done a lot of these things, and you know, look to how he sort of has rewarded his friends and gone after people like Lieutenant Colonel Vindman and others who testified in the impeachment trial.
Amy, what do you make of this?
Yeah, I agree with Pam's point about that. If there's anything that's hurting President politically, it's the coronavirus. The fact that if you look at the most recent polling, on average, the president's disapproval rating, feeling the crisis that we're in right now, is disapproval rating. The majority of Americans believe that on the most important issue facing right now, the president is not doing a good job on that. That is what's weighing this president down, much more so than what is either happening with the commutations or the continuing back and forth with the president and that he's as his political enemies and the tweet storms.
So Amy, or Tam rather, let me ask you about the president's pandemic response. We've seen an administration struggling to message on it consistently and coherently. And this new development, our colleague Amy Shelsendor reported on earlier, of attacking the very same experts who are working with the White House task force to help them respond to the pandemic, specifically Dr. Anthony Fauci. What do you make of that messaging? And also the fact that the president was seen for the very first time wearing a mask this weekend.
Yeah, the president was seen for the very first time wearing a mask this weekend. It's been months since the recommendation was put out, and he actively avoided wearing a mask. He wore it, and then his campaign was sort of shouting from the rooftop, spiking footballs, whatever you want to call it, on Twitter, saying how manly and amazing he looked, and now he's going to win the race. It was sort of an over-the-top response from his campaign to what is a, you know, fairly standard thing that most people are doing, politicians or not. So the White House, in its response and its inability to sort of land on a message, this effort to separate from Fauci or to have Dr. Fauci be less of a public face. You know, part of that is that when Fauci goes out and does these interviews, he often is asked questions that lead to him revealing that there is space between his view and the White House view. And White House officials I've spoken to are frustrated about that. And keep saying, like, well, you know, he's just one of the experts. And yet Fauci has been held up as the expert. He's on socks. He's on donuts and prayer candles. He's everywhere. And the White House is sort of frustrated by that. But, you know, the bigger question is, what is their plan? What is their response? And that is much less clear. It's sort of the going forward strategy on how they're going to deal with the coronavirus. I mean, the president is doing his best not to really talk about it. And when he does talk about it, he's often downplaying it or downplaying the deaths.
Amy, some people are looking at the way the White House has been messaging recently, specifically with regards to Dr. Fauci, and saying he's trying to undermine Dr. Fauci. When you look at how people are viewing those two messengers, what do we know about how people are taking in those two sources of information?
Well, we do know that, at least in the most recent polling, Dr. Fauci has much higher favorable ratings than the president does. He's certainly not polarizing as the president. The other thing we know that this president loves to do is muddy the waters in Russia investigation. Perfect example of that. There are enough stuff out there that people really start to question and doubt what it is seeing and hearing. And if they throw their hands up and say, well, I don't know, it all seems kind of like a mess, that's kind of a win for the president. The problem in muddying the water on a public health crisis is that it actually puts people's lives in danger. And there is absolutely no way for the president to get back the economy that he would like to have, talking about how great the economy was. Before COVID started, he talked about how important it was to get schools back in session this fall. None of that can happen unless COVID is under control and unless people in this country feel safe doing their everyday activities. So
this is, again, the president goes back to his traditional strategy of just make it somebody else's fault or make it unclear so that I don't get the blame. But in this case, when you're president of the United States in a major crisis, the buck definitely stops with you.
Tam, let me ask you about how we're already seeing some indication that the virus could help to shape in some way the presidential election. When you look at some new poll numbers out from CBS News, and you look at three key Sun Belt states, all states that have been hit very hard by the pandemic are seeing surges. In Florida, Joe Biden is now leading President Trump by 6 points. They are virtually tied in Arizona, and Biden is now competitive in Texas. When you look at those numbers and how close they are, where they are today, what do they say to you?
Well, one thing about those three states, it's that they are demographically shifting in that they are states that are growing more diverse, and that would matter. But what matters more now also is that President Trump is doing really poorly with older voters. They had been a critical part of his base, and it's possible he can get them back. But right now, Biden is performing quite well with older voters, who are certainly a presence in those states and are a significant part of why President Trump was able to perform as well as he did in 2016 in those states. And the issue with older voters is the coronavirus is affecting their lives in a very real way. I was talking to a Republican pollster who also does a lot of focus groups with women, who said, grandmothers are mad. Grandmothers are livid. It's not just about, having to shelter in place or, feeling at risk from coronavirus. They can't see their grandkids. And that affects them in a very visceral way.
Amy, let me ask you about some related or possibly related Senate races, too. If you look at these battleground states and you see that President Trump could be vulnerable there, what about other incumbent senators in red states? Should they be similarly concerned?
They should be very concerned, and they are very concerned. You know, I'm not going into 2020. Democrats, they had a little bit of an advantage on the overall playing field. They are not playing as much defense as they were, say, back in 2018. But they didn't have a lot of obvious targets. As the president's numbers sink, that means that Republicans' numbers are sinking, even in places that theoretically, at least earlier this year, looked safe for them, like Iowa, or we put up in that state in Arizona, which is a purple state. But we're starting to see states like Montana come online. And so what this means now is if you're a Republican incumbent in a state that is at all competitive, you should be very nervous, in part because the president is not just a little bit of a drag, but he's like an anchor right now around the ankles of these incumbent Republican senators. If he doesn't see his numbers go up as we get closer to the election, it's going to be very hard for some of these senators. And Arizona is a great example of that. For the incumbent Republican senators to be able to get enough oxygen to win these races. The other thing I'd note about, especially about Arizona and Texas, we had a preview in 2018 of why those states are more competitive. And that, as Tam pointed out, not that they're diversifying, but they're very suburban. Arizona especially, most of the vote, more than 60% of the vote, comes from Maricopa County, which is Phoenix and its suburbs. As those suburbs are changing and as places like Dallas and Houston, San Antonio suburbs, the Austin suburbs become more Democratic leaning, it gets tougher and tougher for Republicans to pull out the kind of margins that they're used to seeing in those kind of states.
There is a lot to track in the weeks and the months ahead. That is Amy Walter and Tamara Keith breaking it all down for us again in Politics Monday. Thanks to you both. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
And on the NewsHour online, the Supreme Court recently made its first major decision on abortion since President Trump took office, and it was broadly seen as a win for the reproductive rights movement. But some scholars and activists caution that the narrow ruling does not necessarily signal abortion rights will be protected by the high court in future cases. We take a look at the implications of that June 29th decision and what it means for abortion access in the U.S. going forward. That and more is on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Since our beginning, our business has been people and their financial well-being. That mission gives us purpose and a way forward. Today and always.
Johnson & Johnson. Consumer Cellular. The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org.
The Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, driven by the promise of great ideas.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.